Okay, welcome everybody. Thank you for joining us as we set a Guinness World Record for the most people to take an online do-it-yourself AT lesson in 24 hours. You've done the hardest part. You've come in, you said you're going to do this. Here's what we need you to do over the next half hour. One, don't skip ahead. They look at how long the lesson was. You need to take at least 30 minutes to complete the lesson. Second part, complete the quizzes along the way. They're not scored, they're not graded, but it does show that you were there and you went through the lesson and hopefully you learned a thing or two, but your scores aren't going to be held against you. So we're about to start our half hour here. Just give you a bit of an overview of what you're going to look at. We're going to really look at how the sort of do-it-yourself maker approach to assistive technology can really fill a gap that's missing for people. We'll talk about some new technologies that people are using in this sort of ethos around 3D printing, how you can get started. And you're going to hear some stories from people with disabilities that benefit from our model. I'm going to spend a little time talking about what is assistive technology, what is do-it-yourself technology, and why it can help. We've been around for 37 years, helping people with disabilities through using technology, knowledge, and passion. A major thread that runs through a lot of our programs is assistive technology, helping people have the access they need to use computers, to go to work, to be successful in school, to volunteer, to paint, to pursue their recreations, to really enable greater participation of people with disabilities. Assistive technology is quite often a missing gap to help people be more fully included. Our Makers Making Change program is a newer program, it's been around 5 years or so now, that's really looking to leverage the maker movement, fabricators, tinkers, you know, engineers, people that have some skills in building things and connecting them with people with disabilities and disability professionals to help make new assistive technologies, many of them released open source so that other people can make it and build on that knowledge. We'll talk a little bit more about Makers Making Change program here in a minute, but just to give you an idea of why this matters, disability is a minority group that cuts across every group, across the world. There's over 1 billion people with a disability. That may be pain, it may be agility, maybe it's an issue with vision or hearing, learning, but it's prevalent. It's about 1 in 7 people. And that's as true in Canada as it is in developing nations. And as we age, we are more likely to experience disability in a permanent factor, whether that's, you know, hearing loss, maybe there's more vision loss, loss of mobility or pain. It's a common thing that as we age, disability rates increase. And many of us experience disability temporarily. I've dislocated my shoulder. I had surgery. It was a couple months where I could not use my right arm at all. So this is something that many people experience directly, and many of us know someone that has some sort of disability. So assistive technology is products, equipment, systems, things that can help increase the capabilities of someone with disability, increase their independence, their ability to pursue their own life, remove some of those barriers for greater participation. Over 80% of people with disabilities use at least one assistive device. Many use more. Many have multiple devices they use in different contexts or different situations for different goals. An example picture I have up here on the screen is our friend Omar. He's using one of our devices called the lip sync. It's a mouth-operated mouse. So instead of using a mouse with his hands, Omar is a quadriplegic, he can't use his hands. He uses this device and that tube, that mouthpiece coming to the lip sync, he can move that up, down, left, right. And on his phone, it moves a mouse cursor up, down, left, right. And then he can sip and puff to left click, tap, and do anything on the phone that anyone else does. So when we talk about do-it-yourself assistive technology, it's a bit more of a bottom-up model to help bring assistive technology to people. We see a number of programs that help people acquire assistive technology when they're at work or when they're at school. But disability cuts across your life, and quite often there can be gaps in those programs in helping people get the tools they need in the situations they need it. So the do-it-yourself assistive technology is sort of building on sort of 3 social movements. One is the maker movement, which is really looking to have people get back to crafting and building things with their hands. We've gotten very used to buying cheap disposable products from overseas. The maker movement is really having people build things again, whether that's coding, whether that's woodwork, whether it's metalwork. And quite often we see newer fabrication technologies being used locally, people 3D printing devices, people using laser cutters to cut things. So in many communities, these tools and resources exist where people are fabricating things, whether that's in the garage or whether it's in a shared workspace. The second sort of tenant pillar of do-it-yourself technology is crowdsourcing. This is where we're looking at having those tinkers, those hackers, those people that like to mess around in the garage to become fabricators, to help make these things for people in their community. You know, many schools, there's robotic clubs building robots. In many libraries now, there's 3D printers. So leveraging that capacity of the community to help fabricate some of these devices for other people in their community. And they're supported through this open source sort of movement. Many people are familiar with open source software, computer programs that are freely available that people can tinker and change the code. We're seeing this now in hardware and devices where people are sharing plans like, here's how I build a device. Here's how you can make that. So on our website, we have a library of different assistive devices that can be made for people with disabilities. It includes the instructions on how to build it, where you can get the parts, 3D printer files or code to help build the device. So volunteers can follow those instructions and use that as a formula to help build an assistive device for someone that they are supporting in the community. There's a number of advantages of do-it-yourself assistive technology compared to commercial offerings. One is cost. So I'll give you an example here, and I have one right here. It's a light touch switch. So switch access, you think if you're playing a video game, you got a number of buttons you're pushing to make your on-screen character do the amazing things. But if you maybe had pain in your thumb or missing a digit, arthritis issues, perhaps playing a video game, pushing those buttons is difficult. You can actually set up your video game console to have different switch input, different buttons in different spots. So whether that's sitting on your foot or pushing your head or maybe laid out more like a keyboard, you can really change the input. But all of alternate switch input, access switches, can be very pricey. Common one used a lot is the microlight switch. It retails for about $85, depending where you get it. We have a plan on our website where you can build it. That's about $5 worth of material between the 3D printer filament, the access button, and the switch. So you can make things much more affordable, especially if you need to start thinking about like mounting it. Many assistive switches have a proprietary mount, which needs a proprietary mounting arm, get really expensive quick. But we have some 3D printed adapters, so you can use a standard camera tripod. Say goodbye for $10 or $15. So you can really drive down the price of some assistive technology by doing it yourself. And there's some other advantages too that I would like to share with you. But if you're wondering what sort of devices are out there, what sort of open source solutions, we have about 150 on our website right now of a variety of different sort of needs for different people. So you can look at the projects, you can see how it's built. And if you don't feel like you have the skills to build it, you can request it and we'll pair you with a maker to help fabricate, work with you to do that customization, to help to build it using their tools. So some of the other advantages of do-it-yourself assistive technology. I talked a little bit about the cost effectiveness that's available, but also customization. I have another item here which I'll hold up to my camera. This is a key turner, just helps hold a key. You can buy these things for $15, $20. You can 3D print it for a couple. We can also customize it. You know, I could do this in any color I wanted. I can make this opening larger. I can put three fingers through here, but I can make it so I can hold four fingers or make it more of a ball on the end that can grip onto. We've also done it where it has a larger sort of slot for the key to go into for those fatter car keys for someone that has a tough time to grab it. So you really customize it to the individual, which can actually help really make it work for them. Not something they try, didn't work, they throw it out, or it sits on a shelf. You can really increase the sort of adoption of the device by having that sort of user input and customizing it to their needs. We've also found that we've been able to reach people in really geographic isolated areas or more rural communities. Many of these community libraries will have a 3D printer, or there's, especially in rural communities, there's quite often more hands-on sort of tradespeople that are able to sell or build things with their hands and using the tools that they have at their disposal. So it's actually a new model to really reach people that maybe not have access to the sort of, you know, professional networks of a more urban center. So considerations, however, if you're going to take a do-it-yourself sort of approach, you know, you may not have that sort of ongoing support. Some may be able to volunteer for a weekend, help build something, but they may have other things in their life. They may not be able to provide ongoing support. There is no sort of when someone builds something, a volunteer, and a one-year warranty where you can just ship it back if it breaks. So it's another consideration. It may take some time to find the right person to help you fabricate a device. We have found that many people who do build a device build a relationship with people and lead to many other projects and devices, but there's no sort of guarantee that that relationship will last forever. We especially find that sort of ongoing piece can happen with students. We've had great projects with students where they work really hard for a period of time on something, and then they go into the next course or they graduate, move forward, and they're not there to provide ongoing support or pieces. So just things to keep in mind if you're taking a do-it-yourself approach. But where we see this model being really successful is when the maker or the volunteer fabricator is working with both the person with the disability, the person that knows what they need, they got the barrier, they're trying to solve it, but also with a disability professional, whether that's someone that's a rehab engineer or working at a nonprofit that serves peers of people with disabilities. They can bring that sort of experience of working a number of people into it. When you have that sort of disability professional experience and the person with disability, and then the maker that can really bring in that, I know I have 3D print this, or I could design this piece, and having that sort of those three pieces overlap is where we really find fantastic outcomes where people with disabilities get cost-effective assistive technology that meets their needs. So we want to share now one of many stories that we have. This one we're going to share is Ashley. She participated in one of our first events of Maker Making Change, our Access Makeathon, which was a 72 hours of people hacking and making different assistive technology for different people with different disabilities. Here's Ashley's story from the Access Makeathon.
I remember when I was 6 years old, my physiotherapist at the time, he gave me a tray and put glasses of water on it. He said, okay, you're gonna walk with this tray from here to that sink over there and go for it. And I was like, I can't do that. Like, he's like, well, why not? I'm like, because they'll spill. Like, it'll spill all over and it'll make a mess. And he's like, so it'll make a mess. It's water and it'll go on the ground and we'll clean it up. I mean, I remember doing it and crying, like bawling my eyes out because it spilled everywhere and I wanted to get it from point A to point B full, just like everyone else would. But he was like, so what? So it's built, you know, so you clean it up. So that was a huge life lesson, like, okay, so it's built, so I'll clean it up. That is a frustration of like, I just poured this tea and I'd really like to drink all of it, but I don't know. 3/4 of it is probably gonna be gone if I don't find someone else to take it for me, so. You could tell that we were both nervous. I was sort of nervous how they were going to take me and accept me. They were nervous to ask me questions and like, what if I say the wrong thing? Is she gonna get mad or be offended? I had probably the nicest team that's ever existed, but I just had to get to the point where I'm like, you were on my team. We want to win or create something that is useful. Ask me what you need to ask me. At first they were like, a couple of their seems pretty simple. Like, are you sure there isn't something else that you... And I was like, well, yeah, you could create like bionic legs, but you've got 48 hours, so I'm trying to help you out here. Anyone should participate in a makeathon if they could, because it will like restore your faith in humanity.
Wow, that's a great story. And it's a perfect illustration of the power of making and how makers and people with disabilities can work with each other to create inventive solutions to everyday problems. Now that wraps up the first half of the lesson. We got a little quiz for you to do. I know what you're thinking. Don't worry. It's not graded. You can't fail. It just helps us prove to the people at Guinness World Records that you've come halfway through the lesson. So take a minute, complete the quiz, and I'll see you back here.